This episode of Because Science is sponsored by Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order.
The fastest way for humanity to expand into the stars might not involve rockets at all, but giant gravitational machines. Let's get technical. How are we gonna get to other stars? If humanity is to ever expand beyond our own solar system and become a truly interstellar species, simply put, we're gonna need more speed. Our fastest rockets move very quickly, of course, moving at many kilometers per second, but for cosmic distances, moving at 10 or 20 or 30 kilometers per second just won't do. For example, imagine traveling to the closest star and the closest planet outside of our own solar system. It's Proxima Centauri B, 1.3 parsecs away, which is 4.3 light years for all you Han Solos out there. Strap yourself to something like a Saturn V rocket, and there is no way we could ever get to this system within even dozens of human lifetimes. It would take 79,000 years, and this is simply unacceptable. To explore the rest of the universe, we must go faster. Yeah, we must go. You know, I know, I'm going. All right, because of current technology, even when we travel within our own solar system, we have to use all the physics and engineering tricks that we can to bring travel times down and go as fast as possible. And one of these tricks that we use to get extra velocity for free is called a gravity assist. Very generally speaking, a gravity assist is when an object like a spacecraft intentionally flies very close to and around a much, much larger body in space, slingshotting around it, ending up on a different trajectory with extra speed. However, if we look at this whole situation from the planet or body's perspective, we can see the spacecraft slingshot around us, but it has the exact same speed it entered with when it leaves. These vectors are exactly the same. And if we think about what space-time looks like during this maneuver, it kind of makes sense, right? If we imagine the planet or body creating a depression in the fabric of space-time, our spacecraft enters the gravitational influence, it picks up speed as it gets closer and closer to the deepest point of the gravity well, and then as it leaves the gravity well, it must lose all that extra speed to return to how much speed it had when it entered. But we know that a gravity assist can give spacecraft extra oomph, so what are we missing here? What we're forgetting is that during a traditional gravity assist, the planet or body that we're using is moving too, and moving really, really fast. If we change our perspective during this maneuver from being as though we're standing on the surface of this planet to being an outside observer watching everything happen, we can see that the planet in question has a lot of velocity too, velocity in orbit. As you can see, the added velocity of the planet changes our math when we do what's called vector addition. The resultant velocity when we enter the planet's gravitational influence gets much bigger when we leave the planet's gravitational influence. This is the gravitational slingshot effect. It's like jumping on a giant merry-go-round that's already spinning and then jumping off with some extra velocity. The reason we can get away with this trajectory trick is because of the conservation of momentum. Think back to jumping on a regular person-sized merry-go-round. If you were to jump onto a merry-go-round as it's spinning, you would increase the mass of the system, and so to keep everything conserved, the rotational velocity of the system would have to go down, and you wouldn't get any extra velocity after you jump off. But in the case of a gravity assist, what you're using as your merry-go-round, so to speak, is trillions and trillions of times heavier than you if it's a planet. So when you enter its gravitational influence, you do slow down the planet, but insignificantly so, and you add a significant to your scale amount of velocity to your movement. And this stealing of velocity is why I call my ship the Velocity Thief. And you can't use that, it's trademarked. Thief away! When a gravity assist is done with precision and intent, it looks like this. Here are the Voyager 1 and 2 probes using Jupiter in separate missions to fling themselves to other points in space. No extra propellant required, no crazy sci-fi engines needed, just math and science working together. The promise of free velocity is why in the 60s, a prolific scientist came up with maybe the ultimate gravitational assist, one that could bring interstellar travel times to acceptable levels. My head's not that big. Slingshotting around space has everything to do with mass and velocity, momentum, and so you may suspect that moving yourself around some celestial object with more mass and more velocity would make for a better slingshot. Well, that's exactly what legendary physicist Freeman Dyson thought too, yes, of Dyson sphere fame. And that's why in a 1963 paper, he came up with a way to slingshot yourself around something with ridiculous velocity using a body much larger than Jupiter and moving a lot faster. White dwarf stars. But this idea wouldn't involve just any old stellar remnant fighting off collapse through electron degeneracy pressure alone. No, this would involve a pair of binary white dwarf stars orbiting each other, either naturally or placed in an unnatural orbit by some ridiculously advanced civilization and orbiting each other really, really fast. No, I know, really fast. I'm getting to it. Just a second.
Yeah, geez, all right. Yeah, I'll do the math. Geez, stop it.
Gravity assists are so promising as a transportation tactic because of how the math works out. So let's imagine that we want to move our spacecraft around our slingshot star in question in a path that looks like this. When the two gravitationally meet and interact, they're going to interact with each other in relation to their relative velocity between them. So if down is positive in our picture here, we can actually add these two velocities together. And on the other side of this maneuver, our spacecraft will actually add the star's velocity to its own, which sounds a little weird, but you can think about it like throwing a tennis ball at an oncoming train and having the tennis ball bounce off at the train's velocity plus the relative velocity between them. A lot of textbooks use that example, but don't throw things at trains. With the right slingshot, a spacecraft could add twice a star's orbital velocity to its own. And if that star is going fast enough, this might all get us quickly across the cosmos. The original paper, entitled Gravitational Machines, envisioned a gravity assist that looks like this. A spacecraft would enter this looping path in a binary white dwarf star system and then fling itself out of the system with twice this velocity. And for orbiting stars like this, all we need to know to figure out what velocity they are orbiting at is their radius and their mass. Dyson envisioned for this scenario white dwarf stars with one solar mass, the mass of our sun, and radii of 20,000 kilometers each. And you have this equation, and you can look up Newton's gravitational constant and the mass of our sun, so... Pop quiz! If a spacecraft could leave a white dwarf system with twice their orbital velocity, how quickly could this slingshot get our spacecraft going? You can look up these values. Here's your equation. I want you to try the math yourself. It's empowering. I'll wait. The correct answer is C. Almost 1% the speed of light. This is the true power of a Dyson slingshot, a gravitational machine that could get us to the nearest star in under 500 years instead of 79,000. But why stop here? If these assists want even more mass and more velocity, why don't we use the densest objects in the universe and make them move even faster? If you squeeze a white dwarf star down even further so that the only thing keeping it from becoming a black hole is neutron pressure, then you get one of the most extreme objects in the universe, a neutron star. When gravitational machines were first conceived, neutron stars were only theoretical, but the math was done on them anyway. You remember our equation, right? Well, let's give our neutron stars some realistic numbers. Let's say they each have, again, one solar mass, the mass of our sun, and each are just 20 kilometers in radius. This star wouldn't even cover all of Los Angeles. So I'm not gonna just tell you what velocity we could reach in relation to light speed because... Pop quiz! You have the variables, you have the same equation. I want you to try to get the right answer for this. It feels really good when you get it. And I'll just wait here. The correct answer is A, a little over a quarter of the speed of light. This is the true power of a theoretical neutron star slingshot, a gravitational machine that could get you going so quickly, you could reach the nearest star, not in generations, but in under 16 years. And as you made this journey, because of time dilation, you would age 7 months less than everyone else in the universe. This is interstellar travel made possible. And it gets even more sci-fi from here. Gravitational machines could in theory be so effective that we could imagine an advanced spacefaring civilization rigging up a network of them across a galaxy. Think of a ship bounding across the galaxy from one neutron star binary to the next artificial system, traveling at a quarter of the speed of light between distant destinations, carrying goods and services and people, making interstellar life possible. And if we couldn't do this, we still might want to look for these suspiciously specific binaries, because if we could find them, it might imply some advanced extraterrestrial intelligence out there. Of course, like any sci-fi sounding idea, there are a lot of problems here too. The first being, we are talking about solar system scale engineering here, something we may be hundreds, if not thousands of years away from, or we just may never get there. And we didn't even mention how incredibly dangerous it would be to manipulate something like a neutron star, something that would spread you across its surface into a thin film of protoplasm just with its gravity alone. And we're not talking about something that is orbiting slowly. In this binary star system, the orbital period isn't like a year, like how long it takes the Earth to go around the sun. It's like 5 milliseconds, extremely quick, and this kind of orbit would, of course, rapidly decay and explode and rip itself apart if not constantly tended to. Hey. I'm trying to run an interstellar operation here. We would need a real mastery over the cosmos to make Dyson slingshots a reality, a humanity advanced enough to move whole star systems around, and right now we kinda have trouble just moving rockets and satellites around. But if we did ever get to this fantastically advanced point, gravitational machines could be a realistic way to extend our cosmic horizon from what planet should we explore next to which star? Because science! Thanks again to Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order for sponsoring today's episode. You play Cal Kestis, a young Jedi Padawan who narrowly escaped the purge of Order 66 following the events of Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith. On a quest to rebuild the Jedi Order, you must pick up the pieces of your shattered past to complete your training, develop powerful new force abilities, and master the art of the iconic lightsaber, all while staying one step ahead of the Empire and its deadly Inquisitors. Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order is available now on Xbox One, PS4, and PC. The reason you can get twice a star's orbital velocity with a gravitational machine like we were talking about is kind of a weird gravitational interaction that mimics a perfectly elastic collision. This is the exact same thing that happens when you drop, say, a golf ball and a basketball together and they both hit the ground and then the golf ball goes shooting way off because of the conservation of momentum. Because the basketball is so much heavier, the velocity gained by the golf ball is so much more. And again, you could prove this by, you know, some throwing a tennis ball at a moving oncoming vehicle. But don't do that!